Good morning, Varinda. So let us start today's class. So today we'll discuss about important concepts in these limit theorems. So that is the weak law of large numbers. So this is something like law of large numbers. So this is one of the oldest laws. It is 300 years old. Now this law gives the exact meaning of expectation or mean. Till now we have seen the mean as a value. So we know how to find out the mean. What is the mean formula? If I ask you, what is the expectation of x formula? That is simply integration x into its PDF. So apart from this, we don't have any meaning for this mu or mean. Now this weak law of large numbers gives the what does exactly mean indicate. Okay. Now so it says that the sample mean of a large number of independent identical distributed random variables is close to the true mean. Okay, so what is sample mean? You have seen in the last class, first of all I have seen SN. What is SN? So x1 plus x2 plus 1 xn. It is simply sum of first n random variables. Now what is mean? It is simply sample mean, that is Sn by number of random variables or number of samples, that equal to x1 plus x2 plus so on plus xn by n. Now this is sample mean. So what does double weak law of large numbers, in the shortest form it is called WLLN, what it says? So if you take sufficient large number of IID random variables and then the sample mean is very close to the true mean. Okay, here so what is the MN, the sample mean? What is the expectation of MN? In the last class I told you, what is it? What is MN? Sum of all random variables by N. Obviously its mean is mu. I hope in the last class I made a mistake, right? It is mu. So what is the variance of MN? Sigma square by n. Am I right? Yeah. So now, so let us study the weak law of large numbers. Yeah. So let x1, x2 be IID random variables with a mean mu, and for every epsilon greater than 0 we have, what do we have? So probability that, so please read the statements properly. So let me prove this. So please try to understand the problem carefully. What they are saying is probability that or MN, MN means sample mean, minus what is the mean of MN? Mu greater than or equal to epsilon. So now here apply Chebyshev inequality. What will you say? So what a Chebyshev inequality says is less than equal to what? What do you write? So what is the variance of Mn? Sigma square by n into the denominator, this epsilon square. You remember or not? What is Chebyshev inequality says? So probability of mod x minus, I am not using the same notations, greater than equal to c will be less than equal to sigma square by c square. So here instead of c we have epsilon. Now here what is the variance of x? Sigma square. But here we have mn, sample mean. What is the variance of sample mean? Sigma square by n. So this is the meaning. Now, so this quantity according to Chebyshev rule is mod mn minus mu greater than equal to epsilon will be less than equal to sigma square by n into epsilon square. But as n tends to infinity, if you take the limiting case, so what happened to this quantity? This quantity tends to 0 because n is in the denominator. Now that's why this quantity, probability that mod mn minus mu greater than equal to epsilon, it is limiting to 0 as n tends to infinity. Now what does it mean? Actually this is a weak law of large numbers we are taking. So what does it mean actually? What is the logical meaning of this? If take large number of samples, so this difference will be zero. This quantity will become zero. So this quantity zero means mn will be approximating to mu. So this difference would be zero, which means mn will be approximated with mu. What is mn? Sample mean or sample average. What is mu? True mean. Simply, so now this theorem tells us that expectation means average. Actually, what is mn? It is something like average, finding the average of the given numbers. What is mn? X1 plus x2 plus so on xn by n. Mn equal to sum of all the random variables by number of random variables. This is what the mean means actually. This is what the sample mean or sample average. So this is nothing but our mean that we found out using the formulas. Both are tending, both are very close to each other. Okay. Anyway, so now that is the weak law of large numbers. That is very, very important. Now, so there is one more concept that is called convergence in probability. Okay. So let y1, y2 be the sequence of random variables, not necessarily independent. Let a be a real number. We say that the sequence yn. What is yn? It is sum of all random variables. Converges to a probability for every epsilon greater than 0. So this is the convergence in probability. If this is satisfied, we say that yn is converges to a in probability. Please remember, it is convergent in probability. Okay, what it says is, if take limit of n tends to infinity and probability that mod of any quantity minus a greater than equal to epsilon equal to 0, which means, what does it mean? Yn converges to A, converges to A in probability. Okay, Now, but just now I told you a weak law of large numbers. What you written here? So let me write properly. Probability that mod min minus mu greater than or equal to epsilon is tending to zero as n tends to infinity. But if I take this as a limit, what could I write? What could I write as a limit? N tends to infinity, probability that mod mn minus mu greater than or equal to epsilon equal to zero. Now you compare this with, so the convergence in probability, you compare that with this. In place of yn I have mn, in place of a I have mu, everything is same, which means, so you just compare, which means I can say that mn converges to mu in probability. Mn converges to mu in probability as n tends to infinity. No need to write this, but it is for your understanding purpose. Mn converges to mean in probability. Now, so same thing is being written here. So we can interpret double LL and as a Mn converges to mu. That is the true meaning of mean. Okay, if you take sufficient large number random variables, mean is nothing but average. What is average? Sum of all random variables by number of random variables. Now, sample mean converges to true mean mu in probability. So, what does it mean? So yn is concentrated around a with a error of epsilon, which means, so yn is around a, maybe a minus epsilon or a plus epsilon. Yn is around a but with some small error. We refer epsilon as a accuracy level, that is accuracy level. So we take epsilon to be generally 10 power minus 6, the accuracy, that's it. Okay, so yn is concentrated around a with a interval of epsilon, and this epsilon is a indication for accuracy or accuracy level. So that is about weak law of large numbers and convergent in probability. So the law of large numbers is very very important. So I forgot to tell you, so here we have discussed weak law of large numbers. No, we have one more law, we have actually two laws, the weak law of large numbers, the strong law of large numbers. We'll discuss this later. Strong law of large numbers. Okay, so we'll discuss in the next class about the strong law of large numbers. So but weak law of large numbers tells us that a sample mean is convergent to true mean in probability as n tends to infinity. So that is the meaning. You must understand the meaning, not the equations. Next, so let us take a problem. So y be the exponential random variable with the parameter lambda equal to 1. So for any positive integer n, let yn equal to y by n. Note that these random variables are dependent. We wish to investigate whether the sequence yn converges to 0 or not. So read the statement properly, read the question properly. So it is about convergent in probability, convergence in probability. So they are asking whether the given sequence yn is convergent to 0 or not, which means what we find out generally, So first of all, let us find out probability that what is the sequence they are asking, yn. Convergent to what? 0. Please make a note of this. Greater than equal to epsilon. We will find out this quantity. So here yn is, we are checking whether yn converges to 0 or not. Okay. But here, so what they mentioned in the problem? So y is the exponential random variable, yn equal to y by n. Okay, so let us solve like this. They gave us that yn equal to y by n. Then this quantity will become probability that mod yn. So yn means, but what is y equal to? Okay, so let me go back here. So yn equal to y by n. So let me replace yn with y by n. Y by n greater than equal to epsilon. Is it okay? So here no need of this mod because it is exponential random variable which is defined for. Now what becomes y greater than equal to n into epsilon. Is it okay? Y greater than equal to n into epsilon. But what is y? Y is exponential distributed random variable with lambda equal to how much? 1. We know already. So this is one of the standard probabilities you must remember. If y is, or x we have defined, x greater than equal to a, what is this answer? E power minus a lambda, isn't it? Compare these two. So this one and this one, here lambda is 1. So what is the probability that y will be greater than equal to n into epsilon, that equal to e power minus n into epsilon. But so the convergent probability, we take limit, no, generally. So how to find out whether it is convergent in probability or not? We take limit n tends to infinity probability that y greater than equal to n epsilon. We have to find out this quantity. So this is nothing but this. We have modified that as y greater than equal to n epsilon. But what is this quantity equal to? This quantity. Now, but so limit n tends to infinity e power minus n epsilon will be equal to what? If n is infinity, e power minus infinity, no? E power minus infinity is 0. Now finally, what we can say is, so let me write this here, limit n tends to infinity probability that mod yn minus 0 greater than equal to epsilon is equal to 0. Now that's why yn is converges to 0 in probability. In probability, IP means in probability, as n tends to infinity. So here I have mentioned this with limit. Okay. So that is about, yes, the answer is yes. It converges to 0. Now, so till now we have seen convergence in probability and weak law of large numbers. Those are very, very important. Try to understand the inference or interpretation. Okay. Now we'll see one of the important topics in the entire course, that is called central limit theorem. So the entire limit theorem is based on these theorems. Simply we call CLT. CLT stands for or the acronym for central limit theorem. We call it as CLT. What it says? So let me take simple logic. I am taking x1, x2, so on, xn are iid random variables. Iid means, so I will write anyway, I will write here independent identical distribution. Okay, here, so all these x1, x2, xn, they are n in number, or random variables, they follow some distribution. We don't know that. Suppose x1 may follow, maybe sometimes they may follow uniform distribution. All these n random variables may be of uniform distribution, or can be binomial distribution, or can be normal distribution. All these may follow different distributions. Here I am calling distribution, I am not saying densities. Okay, it is all about distribution. CLT is all about distributions, not densities. So there is a misconception about CLT. People think that it is about densities. No, it is always about distributions, uniform maybe some distribution, random distribution. Then, so if you take, let me go one by one, Sn. What is Sn? It is sum of all random variables. Sum of all n number of random variables. Then Mn. What is Mn? I have taken n random variables of different distributions. But here they have some mean, and here they have some mean mu, and some variance, finite variance. So all the random variables should have a finite variance, right? They should be iid random variables with a finite variance, and they have different distributions. We don't know what is that. They can be random sometimes, simply random. Now Sn is simply sum of all these things, but what is Mn? Mn is sample mean. We have defined all these quantities already, right? Sn by n. And we have defined one more quantity Zn, intermediate quantity Zn, that is Sn minus n into mu by sigma root n. Now this quantity, so what is the expectation of Zn? What is that? Zero. Variance of Zn? Equal to much? One. We have proved this in the last class. Now here, so this Zn, now let me go to this. Yeah, so x1 x2 be sequence of iid random variables with a common mean mu and variance sigma square. Your variance need to be finite. Then we define Zn. What is Zn L actually? Sn. What is Sn? x1 plus x2 plus so on xn minus n into mu by sigma root n. So the important quantity is, then the CDF of Zn converges to the standard normal CDF pi of z. Read this statement. Now here Zn is defined. Now CDF of Zn approaches standard normal CDF. We denote with this pi of z or some quantity. So this statement is for central limit theorem. This statement tells us everything about central limit theorem. What is this? And here let me write one more sub statement. Irrespective of distributions of xi's. Here, as I told you just now, this x1, x2, so on, xn, they have different distributions. They don't have normal distribution or Gaussian distribution. They may have different distribution, but if you add them, sufficient large number of samples, if you add sufficient large number of samples, then they follow what distribution? Normal. Or you can also call Gaussian distribution. In simple sense, if you take sufficiently large number of samples of different distributions, if you add them, okay, and you calculate this Zn. Zn is nothing, what is Zn? Sum of all random variables minus n into mu by sigma root n. So this Zn approaches standard normal CDF or standard Gaussian CDF pi epsilon. Now, why standard? Because in Zn it is standard. Why? Because we have chosen Zn such that it has zero mean and unit variance. Okay. Now we are defining Zn to get standard normal CDF. Suppose if you take this Sn only, then what happens? You get simply CDF. It is not in the standard form. Are you getting what I'm saying? So this Zn is just to make sure that you get a standard form of CDF of normal CDF. Okay. So if you take just this Sn, you get CDF, but it is not in the standard form. Okay. Now, irrespective of distributions, x1, x2, xn may have any distributions, doesn't matter. If you add them, if you add sufficient large number of those samples, it follows Gaussian distribution. But still here, I am mentioning a misconception. It is not densities. Densities may not follow Gaussian. It is only about distribution. In central limit theorem, we always talk about distributions. X1, X2, Xn are IID random variables with a finite mean. So if you take Zn, that is X1 plus X2 plus Xn minus n mu by sigma root n, then the CDF of Zn approaches standard normal CDF pi of Z. Now same thing is being written here. So converges, obviously. So if take, this is also very, very important. Converges, no? What converges? So the CDF of Zn converges to CDF of standard normal. The notation we know already, that is pi of Z. What is CDF of Zn generally? What do you write? Probability that Zn is less than or equal to Z. This approaches standard normal CDF for all Z. It is a limit, that's why we write limit. So this is what we write. This is nothing but what? CDF of Z. This is CDF of standard normal distribution. Or standard normal, also Gaussian. So that is the reason why in the last class I have mentioned one quantity, RE2 white Gaussian noise. Why is always Gaussian? Because noise means it is a accumulation of several things. Okay, suppose what happens is we are transmitting a signal from one place to other place. Place A to place B. How the signal reaches B from A? There are so many paths. It may go directly, then it may go some reflections, it may go in this way, it may go like this. So a signal from point A to point B reaches via different paths. Now, here each and every path is something like a random variable. It is x1, it is x2, it is x3, and they have different distributions. But at point B, they are all summed up. You are adding all the points. So, if it all the points, they follow only Gaussian distribution according to central limit theorem. So, we don't have to worry about what the distribution of x1, x2, x3, so on, so on. The respective of the distributions, if you add them, they follow Gaussian distribution. That's it. This is the simply about central limit theorem. Okay. So that is very, very, very important. So let us solve one problem. Okay. So we load on a plane 100 packets whose weights are independent random variables. Weights are random variables. Each and every packet has got some weight. That weight is random variable and it is uniformly distributed between 5 to 50 pounds. What is the probability that the total weight will exceed 3000 pounds? Now the problem says we load 100 packets. We have 100 random variables P1, P2, so on, P100. They are IID random variables. Okay. Now, so, but what is the distribution? All are independent and all are uniformly distributed between 5 to 50 pounds. All are, this is uniformly distributed from weight where 5 to 50 pounds. Each and every packet has got some weight between 5 to 50 pounds. Pounds are kilograms. We don't bother about units. So all are uniformly distributed between 5 to 50. What is the mean? What is the mean? A plus B by 2. 50 plus 5 by 2. 50 pi by 2. How much? 27.5. Am I right? Just check it once. I am not sure. Calculate this. Yeah. What are the variance? (50 − 5)² / 12. Calculate this. Okay. So we got 100 random variables of uniform distribution with a mean 27.5 with a finite variance. How much? You calculate. Now what they're asking? In the question, what they're asking? What is the probability that the total weight will exceed 3000 pounds? Total weight means what? Weight of 100 packets. So sum is 100 is nothing but weight of first packet plus weight of second packet, so on plus weight of 100 packets. What they are asking? What is the probability that so the weight of 100 packets will be more than 3000? Here, so we are adding 100 random variables, 100 uniform distributed random variables. Okay, what is we are adding? S, what is S100? Sum of 100 uniformly distributed random variables with a finite mean and variance. Now, so what will happen generally? So here S100 is okay. What is M100? You know what do you mean by M100? Here, what is the value of n, small n? We are taking 100 samples. So this is 100 by 100. What is Zn? Oh, sorry, Z100. is intermediate quantity. S100 minus n into mu by sigma root n, isn't it? So, but what we know according to the central limit theorem? What it says? So, the distribution of Zn or Z100, let me call. So, the CDF of Z100 approaches CDF of, otherwise let me write directly, approaches, let me write CDF of standard normal distribution. SND means standard normal distribution, which means, what do you write? Probability that Z100 less than equal to Z will be equal to pi of Z. Okay, this is what is CLT. But what they are asking? Probability that S100 greater than equal to 3000 pounds. What is this probability? Now, so first what we do? First what we do? Greater than 3000. First what we do? First what we do? Let me calculate this quantity. So probability that S100 is less than equal to 3000. If I calculate this, how to get this? 1 minus this. Okay. So let me go with this first. But so we know this quantity, this is known to us because this is a standard normal CDF table. From if you know Z, I can get this quantity, I can get this probability. But what I want is, I want this. So let us do modification. What modification? Probability that, what is Zn? Z100, S100 minus n mu by sigma root n. So how to convert S100 to Z100? Subtract n mu and divide with sigma root n. So here what I do is, I'll do S100 minus n mu. I'll subtract both sides. And I'll divide with what? Sigma root n both sides. This kind of things already we have done. This simply, but what is this quantity? Zn. So here is nothing but probability that Zn means Z100. Don't take mistake. It is 100. N is 100. Z100 less than equal to, what is this quantity? You calculate. 3000, no? I'm sorry. 3000 minus, you know everything, no? 3000, what is n? 100. Mu, you know. Sigma, you know. Sigma means piece member. It is, sigma means standard deviation. Sigma square means variance. You calculate how much you get. So this is 1.92. So obviously this is equal to pi of 1.92. Otherwise, simply you can say probability that S100 less than or equal to 3000 equal to pi of 1.92. So this quantity can be found out from table, standard normal CDF table. But what they are asking? Probability that S100 greater than 3000. This is nothing but simply, what do you do? 1 minus probability that S100 less than equal to 3000. This quantity we know already. So this is equal to 1 minus pi of 1.92. Is it okay? Now if you know this quantity, you check it from the table, you get the answer. Okay, so that is about probability that the total weight will exceed 3000 pounds. Okay, so we stop here. Thank you.